As people celebrate the Christmas season, may we be reminded that Christ was born that we could have new life. In uncertain times, we can have hope for a bright future and love that brings freedom from fear.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to our Bible Foundations class here at Pathway Ministries Revival Center in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, Canada. My name is Joyce Roberts-McRae, and I'm so glad that you've joined us tonight for our Bible Foundations class. And today we're continuing to talk about being endued with power from on high by the power of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And we started the first part of this teaching, and tonight we have session number 9. So this is part B of the Bible Foundations for being endued with power from on high. We're just going to open with a word of prayer, and then we'll get right into the word. Father, we come to you tonight in the name of Jesus, your Son. We thank you, Lord, for your presence here, and we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for every person that is watching tonight. We pray that your Spirit would touch them powerfully in the name of Jesus. And Father, I thank you for freedom of utterance tonight, Lord, and for the anointing of your Spirit. Lord, that the oracles of God come out of my mouth in Jesus' name, and the word will take root and bear fruit in the hearts of the hearers, and the enemy will not be able to steal it, Lord. And we commit this time of study to you now. We thank you, your word is life, Lord. And we commit this study time to you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. We're going to get right into our lesson tonight, Endued with Power from on High. And we started talking about this last week. And we'll be going on. We won't get finished this tonight. And so tonight we're going to talk about who the Holy Spirit is in us. Last week we started talking about the three baptisms mentioned in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 and 2. And the doctrine of baptisms was one of the basic foundations or basic principles of the doctrine. And there's three baptisms. And so we've talked about the baptism where the Holy Spirit baptizes the repentant sinner into the body of Christ. And the second baptism was when the minister baptizes the new believer in water. And the third baptism is when Jesus himself baptizes us into the Holy Ghost. And so it's wonderful to receive that. Always keep in mind that in Matthew 3:11, John spoke of Jesus, and he said, I, John, indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that comes after me, that's Jesus, is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He, Jesus, shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And so this is a spiritual baptism, the third one. And it's the one where Jesus is the baptizer. And the born-again believer is the candidate. And the element that the believer is baptized into is the Holy Spirit. Now always keep in mind that Jesus himself is the baptizer in the Holy Spirit. So this is an experience that he wants you to have. And when you first get born again, you're born of the Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit who draws you to Jesus, births you into the kingdom of God. And he is the one who baptizes you into the body of Christ the moment that you receive salvation. That was baptism number one. From that moment on, the Holy Spirit is with you, and he will never leave you. But Jesus says that there is yet another dimension of the Holy Spirit that you can experience, and that is of the Holy Ghost not only being with you, but being in you. That's wonderful, being inside of you. And he, Jesus, will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Mm-hmm. And so when he says that he's going to be with us and in us, this is a separate baptism, the separate experience from salvation when you first receive Jesus. And we're going to look at Acts 19:1-6. We'll just review a little bit here. It came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and finding certain disciples, so these people were already saved, they were disciples, and he said to them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And of course, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit are the same person, just different terms that we use. And so these people were already saved, they were disciples, and they said to him, we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, unto what then were you baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. So Paul, the Apostle Paul said to them, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, and that was in water, saying to the people that they should believe on him, Jesus, which was to come after him, which is Christ Jesus. Now when these disciples heard this, they were baptized in water in the name of the Lord Jesus. Okay, so they're saved and they're water baptized. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues. And we're going to spend more time in our next lesson talking about the importance of tongues. But I want us to realize that many times when people are seeking for the baptism of the Holy Spirit and want to speak in tongues, their focus is tongues. Tongues are, the speaking in tongues is very important. But lots of times people are just looking for tongues and not realizing you're receiving more than tongues. Mm-hmm. You are receiving the person of the Holy Spirit. Another person is coming to live inside of you. And just like you received the person of Jesus Christ, when you asked him to come into your heart, he did that. And so now the same way we invite the precious Holy Spirit, who is the third member of the Godhead. We have God the Father, God the Son, Jesus, and God the Holy Ghost. And we invite him in. You're inviting the person of the Holy Spirit to come in. And he wants to communicate with you. He wants to talk with you. And we're going to talk about some of the wonderful things that you have inside of you just because you have him. Now, he's with you from the moment you get saved, but there's another dimension where Jesus baptizes you into the Holy Spirit and you receive a wonderful impartation. Mm-hmm. We talked last week that the Holy Spirit, who is the Holy Spirit? He's the most misunderstood member of the Godhead. He's probably also the most ignored member of the Godhead. And so we want to try and clear some of that up with you tonight. We said last week that the Holy Spirit is deity. He's part of the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. He is called God in Acts 5:34 and 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 1 Corinthians 6:19. And we need to recognize and honor and reverence him as God. And when you receive the Holy Spirit, you are receiving God the Holy Spirit to dwell inside of you. We said last week that the Holy Spirit is not an it. A lot of people say, have you received it yet since you, and they're talking about the Holy Spirit. He's not it. He's a person. And so we call him him. And so he wants to come in. He is called God. And we need to recognize and reverence him that way. So when you receive the Holy Spirit, you are receiving the person of God, the Holy Spirit, to dwell in you. The Holy Spirit is not just a force or a power. He comes with force. He mm-hmm. comes with power. Amen. He comes with influence. But we need to know he's more than a force. So we don't go, the force be with you. Because you're not looking for the force. You're looking for the Holy Spirit, the person. But he has power and might and force that comes with him. Yes. And so, and when you receive him into your life, you receive that power as well. Mm-hmm. And so, if we think of him only as a force or an influence or a higher power, then we deny him the worship and reverence that is due to him as God. And we also make it so that it's hard for us to relate to him, because you can't relate to a force. You can't fellowship with a force. He's a person that wants to speak to you, wants you to speak to him, and he wants to do some awesome things for you. Amen. And so it's hard to love a force. It's hard to love a power. But you can love the person of the Holy Spirit, and he comes with power. We also said the Holy Spirit is not a literal dove. Some people, he's not a bird. Okay, some people think of the Holy Spirit, and of course, the dove is a symbol of the Holy Spirit, but he's a person. He's God the Holy Spirit, a person. And we talk of people, figures of speech we use often. With other people, we talk about somebody being meek as a lamb. That doesn't mean they're a lamb. It means a characteristic they have. Wise as a serpent doesn't mean they're a snake. It means that they have wisdom or wise as a serpent. And the same with the Holy Spirit. The Bible says he descended upon Jesus as a dove or like a dove. So it's a figure of speech. Okay, and we talked last week about the certain aspects of the Holy Spirit's personality that show he is more than a force, he's more than a power, he is a person. Romans 8:27 tells us he has a mind. He who searches the hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit. He has knowledge, Romans 8:27, the same scripture. But God has revealed things unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit, Holy Spirit, searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of man, except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knows no man but the Spirit of God. So the Holy Spirit has knowledge. He has a will. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 11 tells him that he distributes the gifts of the Spirit. We'll talk about them later. I hope we get to that part. He distributes his different gifts to each person as he will. He has feelings and emotions. So a force doesn't have feelings and emotions. He's a person. The Bible says, the Bible speaks of the love of the Holy Spirit in Romans 15, verse 30 talks about the love of the Spirit. Romans 5:5 tells us that the love of God is shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Ghost, or he's poured out in our heart by the Holy Ghost. So when he comes in, you experience this wonderful love because the Holy Spirit loves you. I want you to say that. The Holy Spirit loves me. Just think, give yourself a hug and say, the Holy Spirit loves me. Give him a hug, okay? He also has emotions. He can be grieved. Ephesians 4 verse 30 says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit by whom you are sealed unto the day of redemption. He can be vexed, or that means pained or angered. Isaiah 63 verse 10, the children of Israel rebelled against him and vexed his Holy Spirit. He can be quenched. 1 Thessalonians 5:19, that means he can be extinguished or suppressed or subdued. So it's like, be quiet, don't say anything. You know, there's people today who don't believe that God speaks to people. But Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and another voice they will not follow. And in Revelation chapters 2 and 3, Jesus speaks to the seven churches, and to every one of them, he says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit has to say. Mm-hmm. So we can tell him to shut up, or we can allow him. You know, so many people want to put a damper on him. They don't want him to interrupt their where they're going. But don't quench him. Allow him to speak. The more you yield to him, the more power comes in your life.
Yes.
He can be done despite to. Despite means to be insulted or outraged. Hebrews 10:29 talks about of how much sorrow punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy who has trodden underfoot the Son of God, and has counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sealed an unholy thing, and has done despite to the Spirit of grace. He can be blasphemed against. Matthew 12, verse 31 to 32. Jesus said, wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto man, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto man. And whoever speaks a word against the Son of Man, that's Jesus, it shall be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world nor in the world to come. So it's a very serious thing to speak against the Holy Ghost. Now, there's a lot of people that are worried that they've committed the unpardonable sin. Mm-hmm. You haven't, unless you blaspheme the Holy Ghost. And if you've actually done that, you won't care that you did it, because he's the one who brings conviction in our life, and not condemnation, but conviction. So he lets us know when we've done something wrong, so we're able to correct it and restore fellowship with him. And so he's the one that brings that conviction. And you won't even, if you had actually committed the unpardonable sin, you wouldn't even be concerned about it, because there'd be no more conviction. Okay? Mm-hmm. So a lot of Christians come under that accusation from the devil, and it's not true. So unless you have deliberately spoken against him and blasphemed him, there is forgiveness for all other sins. He can be lied to. Acts 5, verse 3 to 4. Now, you can't lie to a force or power, but you can lie to a person. Mm-hmm. Acts 5, verse 3 says that there was a certain man, Ananias, and his wife Sapphira, who had sold a possession. Excuse me, they'd sold their land, kept back part of the price. God wasn't upset that they kept back part of the price. He was upset that they tried to pretend they'd given all when they hadn't. Mm-hmm. They just needed to be honest. So they come and bring it to the apostles' feet. And Peter said to Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? And while it remained, was it not your own? And after it was sold, was it not your own in your own power? Why have you conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast lied not unto man, but unto God. So first he said, you've lied to the Holy Ghost, and then the Holy Ghost is called God. He said, you've lied to God. So he's part of the Godhead. He can be rebelled against. We already read Isaiah 63:10 with one of the other references there. He can be resisted, Acts 7, verse 51. You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart, you do always resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did, so do ye. So it's not good to resist the Holy Spirit. If you just yield to Him, He'll do a powerful work in your life, and the power of God will come into your life, and He'll use you mightily. And we already said that He speaks, Revelation 2, and both chapter 2 and 3 says that the Holy Ghost speaks, and we are to listen to Him. Okay, that's kind of a recap of what we did last week. We're going to look now at who is this Holy Spirit that lives inside of me and what is His function in my life. So what I want to really stress today is when you receive the person of the Holy Spirit. And what I tell people when they're wanting to be filled with the Holy Ghost and speak in tongues, what I tell them is our focus is not tongues. Our focus is to receive the person of the Holy Spirit. When He comes in, He has something He wants to say, and He wants to say it in His own language, and He wants to say it through your mouth, using your vocal cords, and He wants to speak, and then when you yield yourself to Him, He will speak, and you will speak in other tongues. It's not something you'll make up. You don't have to be afraid of getting the wrong spirit. If you're born again and you're hungry for God, He said that God would give you a good gift. He said, if you're hungry and thirst after righteousness, you shall be filled. Not might be filled, you shall be filled if you're hungry. So the prerequisite for get filled is be hungry. Okay, we're going to talk a little more next week about how to receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit and what praying in tongues has to do with that. But tonight I want you to really focus. I'm not just receiving tongues. I am receiving the person of the Holy Spirit. When He comes in, the rest will follow. Okay? So, John 14, verse 26, in the King James Version, Jesus is speaking here, and He says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, or you may say Holy Spirit, the same person, whom the Father will send in my name. So the Father God is going to send Him to us. He's going to come in Jesus' name. And it says, He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I, Jesus, have said unto you. Now, when it says the Comforter will come, it's a Greek word, parakletos or paraclete, and it means one called alongside to help. Mm-hmm. Have you ever needed help? Mm-hmm. Well, you got a helper inside you when you receive the Holy Spirit. He comes to dwell within you. If you're born again, He is already with you. But there's another dimension where He can come inside of you. And you have the helper living inside of you. You carry the helper with you wherever you go. Because the Bible says that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. So when He comes in and fills you up, you've got a helper inside of you. You've got somebody who comes alongside to help you. And that's really, really exciting. Okay, you have a comforter. That word paraclete, one called aside to help. It also means an intercessor, a consoler, an advocate, and a comforter. John 14, verse 16 and 17 in the King James Version. Jesus is speaking, and He said, I, Jesus, will pray the Father, and He will give you another comforter that He may abide with you forever. Now, the disciples needed comfort because Jesus was preparing them for He was going to go back. He was going to die on the cross. He was going to rise again. And He was going to go back to the Father in heaven. And these disciples had walked with Him for 3.5 years. Every time a need came up, Jesus met it. If they had any questions, Jesus answered them. If they needed a miracle, Jesus did the miracle. If there was a storm and they needed to be calmed, Jesus calmed the storm. And all at once, He's starting to tell them, you know, I'm going to die for the sins of the world. I'm going to be raised again from the dead. And then I'm going to go back to the Father, but I'm going to send you another comforter. And in one place He said, where He said, I will not leave you comfortless, what He really was saying, I will not leave you orphans, because these people got attached to Jesus, and every time they had a need, He was there. But He said, I'm going to send you one like myself, because the Bible says that everything Jesus did, He did in the power of the Holy Spirit. I believe it's Acts 10:38 tells us how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. And so Jesus did everything He did through the power of the Holy Spirit. And He said, I'm going back to heaven, but I'm going to leave you someone. I'm going to send you someone like myself, and He wants to function through you like He functioned through me. And so that's a wonderful thing. So the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, He's one calls alongside to help. He intercedes for us. He consoles us. He's our advocate and our comforter. He says, I'm going to send this comforter, again, back to John 14, 16 and 17. I, Jesus, will pray the Father. He will give you another comforter that He may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, the Spirit of truth, we're going to talk about that later, whom the world cannot receive because he sees him not, it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you. Mm-hmm. At another dimension, he shall be in you. Okay? I like what John 14, 16 says in the Amplified Classic Bible. Jesus says, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another comforter, counselor, helper, intercessor, advocate, strengthener, and standby. Wow, that's pretty powerful, isn't it? Now imagine, you are a carrier of this comforter. When you receive the Holy Spirit, the baptism in the Holy Spirit, you carry God the Holy Spirit inside you. When you need comfort, there's comfort. When you need counsel, there's counsel. When you need help, you got a helper. When you need someone to pray for you, you got an intercessor. And that's the beauty, actually, being able to pray in tongues, because the Holy Spirit prays for things. He intercedes for us, the Bible says, according to the will of God, because he who searches the hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit. And so, you know, in our own mother tongue that we speak in, we can only pray for things that we're aware of. You know, if I know I need healing, I can pray for healing. If I know I need finances, I can pray for finances. If I know I'm going to apply for a job tomorrow, I can pray for that. You know, we can pray for different needs. But if I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, I mean, who at the beginning of this year ever thought that we would be, you know, in March when they started coming all the COVID shutdowns and that, how would you have prayed ahead for that when you had no knowledge that that was coming? But when you pray in the Spirit, even though you may not always know what you're praying, the Bible says it's the Holy Spirit praying through you, and we'll talk about that later, you're able to pray into your future for the things that you don't even know. You can pray ahead of time for the mate you might be believing God for. Mm-hmm. You can pray for direction of what college or school you should go to. Mm-hmm. You can pray what church you should go to. You know, you can pray, you might even have something wrong in your body that you're not aware of yet. And the Holy Spirit will pray ahead for you for different things. And so you're able to pray in the future without that limitation not knowing what to pray for. Okay, and you can cover things ahead of time, even though sometimes the Lord will give you an interpretation. Otherwise, just by faith, you just speak it out. And I'm getting ahead of myself here. Okay, so we see from these scriptures that the Holy Spirit is our comforter, counselor, helper, intercessor, advocate, strengthener. You ever needed strength? Standby. And the Spirit of truth and our teacher and the one who brings the words of Jesus to our remembrance. Have you ever said, well, I can't memorize scripture? I have a hard time memorizing scripture. You know, it's amazing sometimes things I've never taken the time to memorize, but when I need that word, God will bring that word up in my, the Holy Spirit will bring that word up in my spirit when I need it. And so this is who you are receiving when you receive the person of the Holy Spirit into your life. So we're going to break this down a little bit. The Holy Spirit who lives in me, when I invite him in, this is who comes in. He's my comforter. Okay, so this is really important. You know, I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit when I was about 12 years old, I think. And I didn't for a long time, for about 4 more years, I didn't bother to pray in tongues because I didn't realize I could do it at will after that. And so there's things that he can do for us, but the Bible calls him a comforter for a reason. First of all, Jesus was going to go back to heaven. The disciples were sad about that. He said, I'm going to send you somebody like me who's going to be here and comfort you. Okay, but also the Holy Spirit, when I receive the Holy Spirit, I receive a comforter living inside me. When I need comfort, he's in there to bring comfort to me. When I need encouragement, he's in there to encourage me. When the Holy Spirit is in me to comfort my emotions. You ever had emotions that were troubled? Okay, so what do you do about that? He cares about our emotions. Now, we don't live by our emotions. We don't let our emotions control us. But the Holy Spirit is interested in our emotions. And so the Bible talks about in Acts 9:31, how the churches had rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria and were edified. And walking, now let's say walking, that means living, in the fear of the Lord, which is reverence, and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost. Because you have the comfort of the Holy Spirit inside of you, you're able to walk or live in the comfort of the Holy Ghost. And, you know, sometimes when you get upset, you can just talk to Him and say, Precious Holy Spirit, thank you that you're the great comforter who lives within me. Please release your comfort to me right now. I receive it from you right now. And then just lay your hand on your belly and begin to pray gently in the Spirit and allow Him to make intercession for you and through you, according to Romans 8 through 26, till you begin to sense His peace and His comfort rising unto you, rising up in you. Sometimes when I feel like that, I may just go lay down, so I'm just a place of peace, and I just say, Holy Spirit, you're my comforter. Come and comfort me now. And I just put my hand in my stomach and just begin to pray in the Spirit. Oh, the kashanamisondoramani. And you begin to just pray, and as you keep doing that, the Holy Spirit, you're stirring Him up within you, and the comfort of the Holy Ghost begins to rise in you. And even though your situation may not have cleared up right away already, or whatever's troubling you, but all at once the peace of God starts to flood your spirit, and it's really awesome to have that. And you're able to pray even when you don't know the situation to pray about, and it's wonderful. Number two, we said He's our counselor. John 14:16, I will ask the Father, He will send you another comforter, counselor, helper, intercessor, advocate, strengthener, and standby. So in Isaiah 11:2, the Bible speaks of the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon Him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, and the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. So the Spirit of counsel comes into you. Mm-hmm. So when you are confused about something, you don't know what to do, or you don't know which way to turn, you can call on the counselor who lives inside of you. You're receiving the person of the Holy Spirit, this wonderful counselor that comes in, and He's able to give you counsel when you have an important decision to make, or when I have a difficult situation where I don't know what to do. Do I find myself running to other people right away for advice? And there's nothing wrong with going for advice or counsel, but remember the great counselor in you first of all. Amen. Amen. And or do I run first to my resident counselor, the Holy Spirit? And why not allow Him to function as your counselor in matters of everyday living? You don't have to have a crisis to go for counsel to the Holy Spirit. For example, regarding making a purchase. You know, one time I saw something in the store, and I wanted to buy it. And I just thought, and I said, Lord, I really want this. Mm-hmm. I said, Lord, if you don't want me to have this right now, just take the desire away. Because if you deny yourself, then you feel denied, okay? Or you feel like you've lost something. So I said, Lord, just take the desire away. And so all of a sudden, I didn't desire it anymore. I just asked Him. It wasn't a life or death thing. It probably was 40 or 50 bucks. It wasn't a big deal. But I didn't have that sense of being robbed of something because He just took it. Later on, I came back in the store some weeks later. That thing was on sale, and the Lord released me to buy it. And so, you know, you can save money, and God can lead you to deals. You got the counselor inside of you. Don't wait for a crisis to ask Him for direction, okay? Ask Him about making purchases, about making travel plans, what or who to give to. Give something to, whether or not to visit or call somebody, or what to do or where to go today, because He is inside of me to give me counsel. Okay, He is in me. He's in me to give me wisdom. He's in me to give me counsel. He's in me to give me understanding. He's in me to give me knowledge. Yeah. But I need to consult Him, because if you don't ask Him, you know, you need to ask. Okay, and it's important that you do that. Okay, thirdly, number C, He's my helper, the one called alongside to help. And, you know, we can never say that we are without help when we have the Holy Spirit. Romans 8, verse 26, it says, likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities. Now, that word infirmities in this particular case does not mean sickness. Okay, in the J.B. Phillips translation, it actually uses the word limitations. The Holy Spirit helps our limitations. I have a limitation that I don't know. I don't have knowledge about tomorrow. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't know how to pray for tomorrow. Mm-hmm. You know, but I'm limited in my knowledge. But He can surpass that and help me in that area. For we know, it says the limitation that we have is we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Yes. But the Spirit, now your King James says itself, but properly translated, it's not itself, it's the Spirit Himself. makes intercession for us, with groanings which cannot be uttered. So I can never say I'm without help. The Holy Spirit is in me to help me, inside of me. Now, Webster's definition of the word help is, number one, to give aid or to assist. Number two, to contribute to progress or to help you advance. Isn't that wonderful? He's in there to help you make progress in advance. To give relief or to alleviate. To benefit someone by making improvements. Anybody but me needs improvements? I'm sure all of us, we need improvements. And he's there to do that. And he has a neat way of doing it too. It also means to have power, the power to change or the power to prevent something. So the Holy Spirit in you has the power to change you or to change a situation or to prevent you from doing different things. And so he's there to do that for you. He is a helper, is to keep from, so somebody, or to escape, so he can help you, like escape something, helping you. And it also means to wait on, like in a store. Okay, the waiter waits on you in the store, or the clerk waits on you, or in a restaurant the clerk waits on you. And so he's the one that is actually waiting on us to call for help. Yeah. And he's there when we call. He's well, what do you want me to do for you? Where do you want, what do you want help with? And so he's a wonderful person to have in your life. Number D, he's our intercessor. The same scripture that we use there in Romans 8, 26 to 28. The Spirit also helps our limitations, our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself also makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. And he that searches the hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because he, the Holy Spirit, makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. I'm going to spend a little bit of time on this one, because people often take this last verse, verse 28. Do you notice that it starts, verse 28, and we know? Do you notice it starts with and? Do sentences start with and? No, they don't, do they? Okay, so when this translators translated your Bible, there was no punctuation. They put it in where they felt it was best. So it is accurately translated, but the punctuation was put in by the translators as they felt. And you don't start a sentence with the word and. So this "and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, who are called according to his purpose," is connected. And we've used this scripture so many times. We know that all things work together. How many of you know people that all things didn't work together? Mm-hmm. So did God lie? No. Or did we misinterpret what he said? Did we not understand what he said? Because the things that work together for good, we've all seen people who had bad things happen. It didn't work together for good. It was tragic. People who love the Lord. So what happened? Okay? You ever wondered about that? Okay. We'll talk about that tonight. Notice that the Spirit helps our limitations, our infirmities or our limitations, because and our limitation, our infirmity, our weakness, our limitation is that we do not know to pray for as we ought. So when I can't pray in tongues, I'm limited to my natural knowledge of what I can pray for. And I don't even know, even if I know what to pray for, I may not know what the solution is. So I can't pray for that either. You know, so then I start praying my will into stuff. And so so we know not where what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession with groanings which cannot be uttered. You ever had a real burden of prayer where it's like, oh, God, you know? And it's just that Spirit is rising up and he wants to pray through you. And he that searches the hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because he makes intercession for the saints. Are you a saint? Yes. If you're born again, how does he make intercession? According to the will of God. Mm-hmm. So when I'm praying for something and I don't know what the will of God is, if I begin to pray in the Spirit, he will pray the perfect will of God into that situation. And so it's the things that we pray for in the Spirit, praying the will of God, those are the things that work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Notice at the end of 27, he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. The very end of 28, for those who are called according to his purpose. So being called according to his purpose or being according to the will of God is the same thing, right? So when we pray in the Spirit, we pray the perfect prayer. The Holy Spirit prays the perfect prayer for exactly what's needed and the exact solution that we don't know in our little peanut brain mind, okay? And so we are able to surpass that limitation of not knowing what is the will of God, what do I pray for? Even if I have a problem, what's the solution to it? I don't know how to pray for this, you know? And so we can pray in the Spirit, and we'll always pray the perfect prayer in alignment with the Word of God. And those things that we pray like that, they're the things that work together for good because we love God and we are called according to His purpose or His will. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, he is my advocate. Now an advocate, John 14:16 in the Amplified Classic, I will ask the Father, he'll send you another comforter, counselor, helper, intercessor, advocate, strengthener, and standby, that he may remain with you forever. So an advocate, I have an advocate living inside of me. When you receive Holy Spirit, you've got an advocate living inside of you. An advocate is one who pleads another's cause. It's a counsel for defense. One who represents me, one who speaks on my behalf, and one who defends me. Wow. So that's who I've got inside me when I receive the Holy Spirit. Awesome, eh?
Amen.
Number F, he is my strengthener. Okay, and we already read that where he's our strengthener in John 14:16 in the Amplified. And so I want you to say to yourself, I have a strengthener living inside of me. That's powerful. Amen. Jesus said that he would give us this comforter or this strengthener. Ephesians 3:16 in the Amplified Classic Bible says, may he grant unto you the rich out of the rich treasury of his glory to be strengthened and reinforced with might, with mighty power in the inner man by the Holy Spirit. So who's the strengthener and the reinforcer? The Holy Spirit in your inner man, indwelling your innermost being and personality.
Mm.
Oh, wow, that's amazing, isn't it?
Hallelujah.
So you got a strengthener, a reinforcer, a mighty power in your inner man. Jesus said that you will receive, in Acts 1:8, you will receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Now, this word where it says in Ephesians 3:16, I'm reading this one in the King James, that he would grant unto you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might, by his Spirit in the inner man. So we are strengthened by the might of the Holy Spirit in our inner man. That word might, the Greek word for that is dunamis. It's dunamis, dunamis. And that word might or mighty is from the Greek word dunamis, which is also translated power in Acts 1:8, where you should receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Now here's what it means. It means force. It means specifically miraculous power. By implication of a miracle itself. Ability, abundance, meaning, might, power, strength, violence, mighty, wonderful work. Now there's a time to get violent in the Spirit. Jesus said the kingdom of God suffers violence and the violent take it by force. Now that doesn't mean you go out and fight and do violence and all this kind of stuff, but it means that in the spirit realm when you're praying that you are able to come against the forces of darkness that are coming against you with some force, with some power, with violence. The Bible says those violent in the spirit take it by force, and the things that the devil has tried to steal from us and tried to hinder us and hold us back from, we are able to just make our way in there by the violence of the Holy Ghost, the power, the dunamis power of the Holy Ghost, and receive the things that the enemy He's trying to hold back from us. So we shall receive power, dunamis, after the Holy Ghost has come upon us. Now, the word dunamis, we get two English words that are derived from the word dunamis. And they are our English words, dynamite and dynamo. How do you say dynamo or dynamo? Dynamo? Okay, so I shall receive dynamite after the Holy Ghost comes upon me.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
Isn't that something? Okay. If it's like spiritual dynamite where we can blow up the obstacles that stand in our way that the enemy tries to hinder us from. We have a spiritual dynamite within us. Isn't that neat? Amen. You know, no more of this, oh, I'm so weak, I'm so weary, I'm so tired, I'm in another valley again, I hope I can get through it. You know, we're not doing that anymore, but we're starting, if there's an obstacle in the way, you have dynamite, spiritual dynamite inside of you to blow that obstacle out of the way. And that's why the power of the Holy Ghost, you know, he can be gentle as a dove, but he can be powerful as dynamite inside of us. And that's what you receive when you receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit. If you're lacking power in your life, this is what you really need. I promise you. Okay? I shall receive a dynamo inside of me when the Holy Spirit comes upon me. Okay? So dynamite and dynamo. I hope I'm pronouncing that word right. A dynamo reproduces power. But there's one problem with it. It only reproduces power when it's running. Oh. If you turn it off, no more power. Okay? So how do we keep the dynamo running in our lives? Okay, how do we keep that dynamo running in our lives? And we stir ourselves up. Excuse me. By the power of the Holy Spirit, praying in tongues. The Bible says in Jude, I believe it's verse 20, it's only one chapter there. It says but you beloved, building up yourself on your most holy faith. In other words, you're recharging yourself, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. So as you begin to pray in the Spirit, you are building yourself up, recharging yourself, making that dynamo run. You know, the Bible says that we are to pray without ceasing. Have you ever tried to pray for an hour in English or in your mother tongue? It's kind of hard sometimes, isn't it? And to pray without ceasing, like never stopping, how would that be possible? But the only way you can pray without ceasing is by praying in the Spirit. Now, I pray in English, I pray in my mother tongue, but I'm used to yielding to that now. I easily switch, almost without recognizing it, I'll switch from my mother tongue, from English, into praying into the Spirit, and it's just so normal. It feels so normal because I've learned to yield to that. Yeah. And it's amazing sometimes just the different expressions of the Holy Spirit that come out as you begin to speak. It's wonderful. And so you charge yourself up in the Holy Ghost. There's people who got filled, who have received the baptism in the Holy Ghost, but they never run the dynamo. And so they've received and they've spoken in tongues once, but they don't stir themselves up to keep it going and keep it alive in there, keep them alive and that gifting alive in their lives. And so they walk around like they have no power. And I've met lots of Christians like that, and you probably have too. Micah 3 verse 8. The first part of verse 8 says, Micah says, but truly I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord and of judgment and of might. There's that word might again. I tell you, the Holy Spirit, he's powerful. And, you know, the devil's no match for him. Yeah. And if we begin to realize, you know, it's amazing when Paul began to cast out evil spirits in the name of Jesus, and there was the seven sons of Sceva that were trying to do an exorcism on a man, but they didn't have the power of the Holy Spirit, and they didn't have the right to use the name of Jesus either. And so they tried to cast the spirits out of this man, and they said come out of him in the name of Jesus who Paul preaches. And the demon spoke out of the man and said, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? Okay, and so they had no power to withstand the power of the enemy. And because when we receive the Spirit of the Lord upon us and he comes in, part of our duty then is to set captives free. Isaiah 11 verse 2, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. Now here's who the Spirit of the Lord is: the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of might, the Spirit of knowledge, the Spirit of the fear or the reverence of the Lord. That's what all comes in when you receive the Holy Spirit. That's what he comes in with, and it's powerful. He's my standby. I have a standby living inside of me. Isn't that wonderful? Now, Webster's definition of the word standby is one that can be relied on. Also means ready or available for immediate action or use. Amen. Okay? Collins' definition of standby is something or someone who is always ready to be used if they're needed. And the term standby can also be used for something like a standby generator. when electricity or power, when the electricity or a power source shuts down, the standby generator kicks in immediately so that the things can, continue to function without interruption. You, when you come to the end of your own strength and you come to the end of your own power, you got a standby inside, a standby generator inside of you. His name is the Holy Spirit. And if you begin to pray in the Spirit, He begins to build you up and strengthen you and recharge you so there's more power to continue on to function without interruption. Amen?
Amen.
He's my teacher. I have a teacher living inside of me, John 14, 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, or Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and he shall bring all things to your remembrance. So I have a teacher inside of me. And you know, he's not only there to teach us spiritual things, he will teach you things in the natural. You know, years ago, I used to play accordion years ago, and I would go home, and I'd say, Lord, teach me something new. I played, but I'd say, Lord, teach me something new on my instrument today. And I've done that with the piano as well. But I said, Lord, teach me something new. And then I would forget about learning something new, and I'd just go into worship and begin to play. And all at once, I'd start doing something that no person taught me. No piano teacher taught me. Music teacher taught me. It was by the Holy Spirit. And so he can teach you wisdom and whatever it is that you need, whatever you need to operate or function, he's able to give you the wisdom. You got the teacher inside of you. Mm-hmm. I have a reminder inside of me, the one who brings the words of Jesus to my remembrance. Like I said, even things that you may not have memorized the scriptures, he'll bring it. If you've gone in the Word and you've been in the Word, he'll bring that to your remembrance when you need it. He's my guide. He's the Spirit of Truth. The Bible speaks of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Truth, that in John 14, 16 to 17, and it says that he will guide you into all truth. He's there to remain with you forever. Okay, the Holy Spirit, the truth-giving Spirit. John 14, 16 and 17, I will pray the Father, he'll give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. Think about that. Today, we're living in a day of great deception. I mean, everywhere you turn now, you hear so much deception. How can you separate? You know, the media is full of deception. Mm-hmm. And sometimes things we hear preached are full of deception. And new doctrines that people get tossed from every wind of doctrine, from one doctrine to another, because they're not grounded in the Word of God. But the Spirit of Truth, if you listen to him, he'll witness with your spirit when you hear something. And sometimes I've heard a teaching that sounds really good, and then all at once it's just got a little something in it, and you almost don't catch it, except the Holy Spirit will bring it to your attention. Yep. And you think, well, I'm going to go check that out when I get home. Mm-hmm. You know, the Spirit and the Word of God always agree. The Holy Spirit will never contradict the Word of God. So if somebody's preaching something and you can't find it in the Word, then go back and check with the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, you're the Spirit of Truth. Show me the truth about this. The Bible tells us in Matthew 24:24 that if it were possible, even the very elect would be deceived in these last days. That is why you need to pay attention to the witness of the Holy Spirit in your heart when we hear different teachings. Make sure it lines up with the Word of God, exactly. Rightly divided. The Holy Spirit and the Word always agree with one another. So when you're listening to a teaching or you're in a class and someone's teaching you something, make sure you find it in the Bible. Wow. And if you can't find it there, then it can't be from him. And you go back and ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, show me the truth about this. And he will do that. He is the Spirit of Truth. And if you will ask him, he will lead you into all truth. Okay, and guide you. Number five, the Holy Spirit is our sanctifier. I have a sanctifier living in me. What does it mean to be sanctified? It means to be set apart for a holy purpose. Yeah. 2 Thessalonians 2:13 says, we are bound to always give thanks for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God has from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. So there's truth together with being sanctified and walking in the truth of God. Okay? 1 Peter 1:12, 1 verse 2 talks about the sanctification of the Spirit. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. That's W-H-O-L-L-Y. And I pray, God, that your whole spirit, and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now we know that Jesus Christ is coming. By the signs of the time, we can tell that Jesus Christ is ready to come back any time, and we're waiting for his return. So in the meantime, he wants our born again spirit to be sanctified, set apart, and holy. He wants our soul, which is our mind, will, and emotions, to be holy, and he wants our body to be holy and sanctified, and he wants our body also to be sanctified. Mm-hmm. Okay, and so that's why we're going to look at the next one, verse number 6. The Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit. He is the Spirit of holiness. Yes. So he is in me to help me live a holy life. Yes. The word holy means sacred to God, set apart for God, pure. And 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, "Know you not that you are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwells in you? If any man defile the temple of God, that's your body, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God, your body, which temple you are, is the temple of God is holy, which temple you are." 1 Corinthians 6:15 to 19 says, "Don't you know that your bodies are the members of Christ? Shall I then make the members of Christ, take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? God forbid." So he's talking about sexual immorality here. And how your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. So you don't want to unite with something that is not of God. Mm-hmm. What? Know ye not that he which is joined to a harlot is one body? For two, saith he, shall be one flesh. But he that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. Flee fornication, that's sexual immorality. Let every sin that a man does is outside of his body, but he that commits fornication or sexual immorality sins against his own body. What? Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost who is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? You are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Mm-hmm. So this body, when you receive Jesus, it doesn't belong to you anymore. It belongs to him.
That's right.
And so we need to keep that temple pure. And you need to think before you go to do something, whether it's immoral or you're tempted to do something, the Holy Ghost is in me. He's going to be noticing this. Do I really want to defile my temple, who the Holy Spirit lives in? And you don't need to yield to those things. Amen? So he says in 1 Peter 1, verse 15 and 16, "He which has called you is holy, so be ye holy also in all manner of conversation," or that means behavior in that word, "because it is written, be holy, for I am holy." Okay, the Holy Spirit is also the spirit of the fear of the Lord. Isaiah 11:2, we looked at, "The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the spirit of the fear of the Lord." And so we need to reverence God. We need to reverence the Holy Spirit who lives inside of us. Mm-hmm. Sometimes he's trying to speak to us and we're ignoring him. That's being irreverent to him. Sometimes we want to go and do something that we know is wrong, and the Holy Spirit inside saying, "Don't go there, don't go there." And we decide we're going to barrel ahead and do it anyway. That's being irreverent to him. We need to walk in the reverence of God. And when we talk about the fear of the Lord, it's not talking about that we're so scared God is going to send a lightning bolt and strike us for every little thing. God loves us. But because we belong to him, he wants us to walk in reverence toward him and respect toward him. Okay, and we're going to stop there at the moment. And so I hope you've received something from what we studied tonight. And, you know, if you're watching tonight and maybe you've never received Jesus as your personal Savior, that's the first step. You need to receive him into your heart, and then you're a candidate to receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit. You can receive him after you get saved, even a minute after you get saved. But you need to first make sure, because the Bible says that the world or the unsaved cannot receive this Holy Spirit. But once you belong to Jesus and you've given your heart to him, he's there for you, and he's available when you call on him. So we want you tonight to know that God wants you to know that he loves you, and he has a wonderful plan for your life. The Bible tells us that Satan, the thief, also has a plan for your life. He has come to steal and to kill and to destroy. But Jesus Christ said that he came so we could have life, eternal life, an abundant life, life to the full till it overflows. So which plan will you choose? Are you going to follow the wonderful plan that God has for your life? Or are we going to follow the plan that Satan has, because he's only there to steal, kill, and destroy. The Bible also tells us that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, that whosoever believes or puts their trust in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. You know, we're coming near to the Christmas season right now when we are celebrating the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Some of us just think of him as a baby in the manger, but next time he comes to earth, he's coming as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But God said at this time in this Christmas season, we are celebrating when God sent his most precious gift that he could possibly give when he sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, from heaven to earth. The Bible says that he sent him that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 7:14, saying, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us." So Jesus is the God-man who willingly left his home in heaven to come to earth and be born as a baby in a manger. Jesus was born to die. Imagine that. Jesus himself, the God-man, he was born to die. Romans 3:23 tells us that the wages of sin is death. And spiritual death is eternal separation from God, or what we call eternal damnation in a place called hell. But Jesus lived a sinless life on our behalf. But then he who never sinned, 2 Corinthians 5:21, he who never sinned took our penalty and our sins on himself when he went to the cross of Calvary to die in our place. He died to remove our sin. Sin was the barrier that stood between us and a holy God. And now our relationship with God can be restored, and his gift of eternal life is now made available to us. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and he was buried and rose again the third day according to the scriptures, 1 Corinthians 15:3-4. Let me ask you a question. Have you accepted God's free gift of eternal life? If you were to breathe your last breath today, do you know beyond a shadow of a doubt where you would spend eternity? Would it be eternal life in heaven, or would it be eternal damnation in a devil's hell? There is a hell to shun, and there is a heaven to gain. And you don't have to go to a devil's hell. You can know for sure, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that you are forgiven, and that you have eternal life, and that you're on your way to heaven to spend eternity with Jesus, the one who died for your sins and paid the price so you could be there. The choice is yours. Will you accept the free gift of salvation, the free gift of eternal life that he offers you? You know, there's going to be a lot of gifts under the tree this year, this Christmas again. How would you feel if you put a gift under the tree and it came time to open it and the person that you were giving it to never opened it? Make sure you open your Christmas gift from God the Father today, the gift of eternal life, the gift of salvation. He sent his only Son. The Bible tells us that all have sinned. You know, living a good life isn't enough in itself. We have all sinned and come short of the glory of God, or the purpose for which God created us. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Salvation, eternal life, it's a free gift, and it's yours for the asking. If you want to receive the free gift of salvation, the Bible tells us that whosoever, that's you, shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And the Bible also tells us that if we confess with our mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart a person believes unto righteousness or right standing with God, and with our mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever, that's you, believes or puts their trust in Jesus Christ shall not be ashamed. If you would like to receive Jesus Christ into your heart as your own personal Lord and Savior and be born again, be saved, pray this prayer with your heart and with your lips out loud. Just say, Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. You said in your word that if I would confess with my mouth Jesus as my Savior and my Lord, and if I believe that you raised Jesus from the dead, I will be saved. So, Lord, I do believe. Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart, be my Savior, be my Lord, be my friend. I repent of all my sins, and I ask you to forgive me. Take out the stony heart and put in a heart of flesh. Wash me. Cleanse me. Let me never be the same. I renounce Satan and all his works and all his ways. And I renounce all false religion. I turn my back on sin, and I follow you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for dying on the cross and shedding your blood for me. Thank you that 3 days later you rose again from the dead. And thank you that you're coming back again. I confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He is my Savior and my Lord. And right now, by faith, I receive the free gift of salvation. I'm saved. I'm born again. And I'm on my way to heaven because I have Jesus in my heart. I want you to take an imaginary key, lock the door of your heart, throw the key away, and say, Jesus, I'll never let you out. If you prayed that prayer and meant it from your heart, all your sins are forgiven, and you have become a child of God. Welcome to the family of God. I want to encourage you to read your Bible daily. That's God speaking to you through His Word. Take time to pray. Just talk to God every day. You can talk to Him about anything and everything. There's no subject that's off limits. And become part of a Bible-believing church. Be around strong believers. And share your faith with other people. If you make a mistake, always remember to run to God and not from Him, because He loves you and He has a wonderful plan for your life. And if you prayed that prayer tonight, contact us and let us know about your decision. Amen. Here at www.pathwayministriesrevival.com. God bless you, and we will be with you next week to continue our study on being endued with power from on high. God bless you. Have a great rest of the week.
Amen. And we're just going to have your husband just come and release a prayer over everyone watching.
Okay.
For healing, and that the Holy Spirit would just touch them with fire. So, Bob, just come.
Okay. Just sit down here, Bob.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. God just wants to touch everybody.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Father, we come to you tonight, Lord. We come, we thank you for being such a wonderful, powerful Lord. We thank for all your salvation, the gift you've given, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that tonight, Father, the people out there that are struggling or having fear or not feeling well or sickness, any sickness, whatever it is, Father, I ask you to touch right now with the powerful name of Jesus, Lord. You are the healer. You died on the cross and took those stripes for their healing tonight, Father. And Father, I thank you, Lord. I come against any depressing spirit. I come against all spirit of fear. I cut it off. Any sickness that's not of you, we cut it off, Lord. Cancer, we curse. Command it back to the pit of hell. Let them be healed. Heart trouble, Lord, we heal. And we thank you, Father, that every need, Lord, even if they need peace tonight, you are the peace giver. And we thank you, Father, because we glorify you. It's all in your wonderful name. And everything bows at the name of Jesus, at the name of Jesus. So we thank you, Lord. You're the great healer, the great physician. You're the baptizer and soon coming king. So we thank you, Father, that every need tonight, out in that airland tonight, Father, meet it, heal. Father, meet every need. Supply, Lord. We thank you, Lord. You're the bountiful Lord, Lord. Financially, Lord, we pray you move in a mighty way. And we thank you most of all, Lord. Touch people with your joy. Your joy tonight, Father. We thank you for your mighty breakthrough in Jesus' mighty name. We give you the praise. We look for a good report that people have been touched, set free. And we thank you, Lord, and we give you the praise because you're King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And everything, you should ask anything in my name. In my name. So we ask in your name tonight, Lord, we give you thanks, we give you the glory, we give you the honor. We say, praise God, for great things are done. We thank you for every breakthrough tonight, Lord. Every soul that's been born again must set free. We thank you for it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
As people celebrate the Christmas season, may we be reminded that Christ was born that we could have new life. In uncertain times, we can have hope for a bright future and love that brings freedom from fear.